Just in time for Halloween, so you know exactly who we're going to talk about today. Our invisible, spooky little Ghost. Ghost really has very little screen time, but comes into the series at a very pivotal moment. Just like Antarcticite. The anime leaves out the Ghost plotline, so whenever we do end up getting Hoseki no Kuni Season 2, I will most likely be crying seeing our poor, silent Ghost get ripped apart for Fosa's sake at the beginning of our season. Ghost embodies this idea of a passive onlooker. They aren't in this state all the time, as the one instance that Ghost actually becomes a very active participant is when Karen Gorn contemplates removing their inclusions from their eyes, which I have stated before is one of the highest emotional peaks of the series for me, but it fits more with a video focusing on Karen Gorn, and for this one, I only want to talk about Ghost Quartz, and not the little gem inside. Obviously, it's impossible because the line between Ghost and Karen Gorn is almost non-existent as to where one stops and one begins, but we will navigate through this distinction together. With a passive onlooker, the character plays his observing role, looking down on a scene that is taking place, but there's usually the moment where this character doesn't fully understand or fully interpret the scene correctly. Fos, Ghost, and Kongo have different levels of this observer role throughout this small stretch of chapters, from Ghost's introduction in chapter 32 of the manga to chapter 38, when Ghost gets taken up to the moon. Now, during this little stretch in half of Volume 5 to the beginning of Volume 6, Fos is looking for a way to communicate with the enemy, with the Lunarians, when Fos can't even effectively communicate with their own gems. They have this sneaking suspicion that Kongo is related to the Lunarians because of Shiro, but none of the other gems in Fos's eyes seems to notice or care, which is very ironic because almost all of them have had this question before, but chose to trust in Kongo, while Fos cannot accept this. To double down on this, Kongo can't even communicate properly because of the restrictions placed on him due to his makers when he imprints on these gems themselves. A vicious cycle of miscommunication and false trust that spirals on for millennia because these gems are immortal and it's hard for them to change. That's why Fos's attempt to talk is admirable, and even Ghost makes this point that when Fos had their real first job as a natural historian, they never made the effort to come to a resource that is filled with knowledge, the library. This tells us that Fos has finally gotten motivated to chase after the truth, in this instance because there are real stakes. Fos made that promise, and even if they don't remember how fun or how fully that promise was, the idea of owing to someone else generates enough of a strong desire, much like our Ghost here. Ghosts can't live on their own. Even at the point of creation, they encompass another and form around creating this hollowness and a shell for another to be safe. Karen Gorm is that sheltered little sibling, but with a vicious attitude of a backseat driver. Someone who sees too much but can't act accordingly because Ghost is generally the one mostly in charge. Hoseki no Kuni has this running theme of ignorance is bliss, as gaining more information never leads to the path that you want it to go, as we see in Fos's journey, but we can even relay this to Lapis as well. When Lapis gets attached to Fos, those disgusting details causes the mind to think too much, making them act more predictably and right into Enma's hands. Ghost and Karen Gorn have double the eyes and double the inclusions for information gathering, but are unable to keep up with the one that they care for, Lapis. Ghost feels so guilty about their shining gem, their partner that was taken, that they overburden themselves to do the job of Lapis, waiting forever for the rest of the body to come back to the conveyance center. And ironically, that center is just a filler role anyways, because none of these pieces that our gems have been collecting from the Lunarians are worth anything, because the inclusions won't attach to something fake, something synthetic. So Ghost's original role is useless, and they are inadequate to handle it because the right information isn't accessible to them. Even if those pieces look real and functioning, they are far more broken than one's eyes can tell. Treading carefully is one thing that Fos is terrible at doing and Ghost is very, very good at doing. The wonderful wordplay that Ichikawa does is that when Lapis says it's rare, when we have the three spots and it's rare to see three at once, it ties back to when the last time we had a set of three gems together. It was Fos and the twins. Back then, it was Fos's inability to move their own legs in one direction or the other out of a indecisiveness that Bort had to come and save the day, or the twins would have both gotten sent up to the moon. Here, Fos chooses not to act to see what Kongo will do. The first time was caused by fear, this time was caused by suspicion, and that's why he eats away at Fos when they get a thank you from Ghost, because Fos doesn't believe they deserve it. This thank you from Ghost's point of view is cherishing another gem to reach out, but again, Ghost is an observer themselves and they don't have the full picture, because when we see it from Fos's point of view, I mean, even though they reached out, they only reached out until Kongo started to act. And that guilt is painful, of not being able to do something, of the one time where being impulsive would have been a good moment, but you chose not to think back, to reflect, and that almost took away someone you cared about. Now in this scene, we have three observer roles. Ghost feeling that Lapis might be on the cloud because Cairngorm probably berated them to check. And we don't normally see Ghost on patrol, so this is probably a rare occasion for them to look for Lapis. Little does a Ghost know that there's no new types in any of these clouds, just a simple misdirection. And then there is Fos's point of view, who prioritizes Kongo's actions over the Lunarians and the safety of another because of that truth. Fos overreacted earlier at Kongo, going against the advice that Pat gave them to tread lightly, so they underreact and just watch. And now Kongo obviously reacts immediately and even sacrifices pieces of themselves to get Ghost back, not even caring that another gem is watching them while they do it. And like, the self-sacrifice and the power to be self-sacrificial is something that Fos wasn't able to do in the past, but now, even if they have the chance to do it, their priorities causes Fos to lose sight of what is important to them. Actually, not even lose sight, but their attention can only be held for one task at a time, and this time, it almost came at a cost of another. And Kongo doesn't even hesitate and looks at Fos with their true eye of happiness and asks for that be kept a secret, because Kongo doesn't want the gems to suffer more for his cause, which is what's currently going on. So now Fos has to pick up yet another burden, the opposite of happiness that this eye is supposed to bring. Now this panel is one of the most powerful ones since the hiatus for me, because it really did come true. Fos will be all alone, repeating the cycle of gaining freedom but lacking the power to achieve the goal that they currently have. I don't normally talk about paneling or framing with these videos, but let's try it here, because I did notice a few things. Fos's right eye, which ends up picking the true eye in the future, sees in this corridor our future for the gem as a never-ending road of black and white that eventually gets filled with gray. That outside gray sky gets flipped inside and the white innocence gets gutted to the world to see. Fos, for 10,000 years, will have to continue to deal with the actions and inactions they took throughout the course of their life to where they ended up, all alone on Earth. Happiness is never close by. It is just an illusion, just like the war journal. Another great parallel with the paneling is an iconic shot of Fos when they say, "I guess I'm just tired," with this white background and a slight smile that is emulated perfectly by Ghost a couple chapters later, when Fos, who's mostly covered in the dark, says that Ghost was probably happy when they were with Lapis, and we get no response. It gets me to think that yes, they probably were, but the feeling is way more complicated than just happiness. Maybe they were actually a little tired of Lapis as well. Lapis, as we learn later, is very manipulative, so even though Ghost and Cairngorm might think that they were happy, this was probably an intended result of Lapis's affection. Or another way to read this scene is that Ghost didn't answer here because Cairngorm was the one that answered, and that's why we get the silence. Ghost, and by extension Cairngorm, are heavily dependent on some figure to tell them what to do and when to do said things. They don't like to think because There are too many conflicting thoughts going around all the time, pulling their body and minds in opposite directions. But Lapis was able to give them both their love and respect, and when Lapis was around, they probably moved and acted in unison. They were truly happy because they had a sense of direction in their life. And obviously, Kongo has the same effect on most of the other gems, but Ghost and Cairngorm latched onto Lapis in this case. So wanting to have that sense of peace and normalcy is what Ghost and Cairngorm craved from Fos. And it's not just Ghost that wants this, right? Bort follows orders like a soldier and is battle crazy for that reason. And even Cinnabar self-imposes orders to isolate themselves, even if they want to be together with everyone. These conflicting thoughts and these conflicting feelings are negated because of a powerful, not overbearing, but a motherly figure or a parent, like a parental figure. And it's interesting that Fos, as going through their journey, as picking up different parts of other individuals and their inclusions, getting some more freedom, whether it's the legs or the gold or Lapis's head, continues to have these conflicting feelings as well. And that's why they don't have full control over their own actions, and a lack of memory also causes their personality to change as well. So let's talk about why does Fos's alloy break down in this moment when they tell Ghost to back them up? And it's not just a plot contrivance, but a mindset that Fos is in. Fos doesn't actually want Ghost to back them up. They don't want to drag anyone else into it. The guild from not stepping in is catching up to them in this place, and when they think back to their conversation with Cinnabar, and all those hopes and dreams that Fos subconsciously knows can never come true, that's when they falter. The goal of going up to the Lunar Cloud was to gather clues, not to reminisce, and Fos paid that price dearly. This is why I said that they only can focus on one task at a time, because the other thoughts kind of overload their inclusion capacity to take action and become that passive onlooker, resulting in their inability to control a complex amalgam as heavy as gold platinum. So then on the flip side, why does Ghost take action here? Because they were unable to take action in Lapis's case, and they don't want a repeat of that mistake again with their Lapis insert Fos. When Cairngorm chooses to be in compliance with Ghost and give them proper meaningful guidance in this fight, Ghost ends up disappearing. This is the one time where their conflicting thoughts actually has a negative effect, because they're not seeing all the sides. That feeling of comfort is gone. That voice that's always there is gone. That other set of eyes is gone. That security and compassion is gone. Even if they didn't agree, they definitely cared for each other, and Fos is the reason for the separation. Similar to Kongo's self-sacrifice with their own pieces of their arm, or Diamond using a dangerous technique to try to be useful, Ghost chucks that piece of their arm as bait as well. That part of both Cairngorm and Ghost goes over just to give enough time for our poor Fos to get out of there. And that final promise that Ghost can physically say is just one thing: we couldn't protect Lapis, so please protect Fos. Now Ghost is now truly biggest of a passive onlooker, with only able to see things in the world with the tiny inclusions of the eyes that Kongo placed there. Similar to how Kongo has Fos's eyes tucked away and in possession, Kongo is the one that makes these gems both very passive and very active. Kongo shapes their worldview, and the other gems reinforce that security and society in protection of Kongo, the one who could have potentially freed them all. Cairngorm obviously goes through a whole set of breaking the shackles of their prison, but was it really a prison, or was Enma just very good at twisting words to get a reaction that is agreeable to his plan? Obviously, he's very much biased towards Cairngorm and does not care about Ghost. As we see, like, Enma only cared about that black luster and chipped away the white or the transparency that Ghost was, chipping away that sense of security. And even if Cairngorm gets this kind of freedom, is it freedom of their own choosing, or is it freedom because it was another influence, right? They, both Ghost and Cairngorm, have never been independent in their entire life. And just because there's this idea of independence given by Enma doesn't mean it's actually true independence. But anyways, we'll talk more about that in a Cairngorm focused video. I don't want to, obviously, yeah. I didn't actually know that this October is the 9th year of the series. We are, the series started October 25th, 2012, which is crazy to think about. I actually caught up in end of October of 2020, which is awesome. So next year will be the big decade of Hoseki no Kuni. So I'll do something big. I'll try to do something big. Hopefully we do get an announcement about its return in a couple of days, but nonetheless, next year, will it be my highly anticipated FOSIS video? Who knows, but we shall see in a year's time. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you guys next month.